Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for being here for the St. Mary's County Alcohol Beverage Board meeting of April the 13th, 2017. A couple introductions real quick. We have our recording secretary, Susie Wilden, Sheriff's Office Representative Sergeant Steve Myers, Board Attorney Jim Tanavage, Board Administrator Tammy Hildebrand, Board Member Leonard Cole, Board Inspector Mr. Garland Thompson, Board Member Kevin Hall, your co-chair Linda Pachinski, and I would be your chair, Ted Bellavoine. First order of business is approval of minutes from March 9th, 2017. Do we have a motion?
I make a motion that we accept the minutes for the Alcoholic Beverage Board meeting of Thursday, March 9th, 2017.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Carried. Thank you. Send that down there, will you?
Thank you.
So you're going to skip the...
No, he's in. He's here now. We're ready to go, correct?
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
First order of business is a violation of St. Mary's Fine Wine and Spirits. Young Ha Kim, sale of alcoholic beverages to an intoxicated person in violation of Section 6-307 of the Alcohol Beverage Article of the Annotated Code of Maryland and 5.04I of the Rules and Regulations of the Alcohol Beverage Board of St. Mary's County. Mr. Kim, please come up to the mic.
Hello, right to the speaker there. Raise your right hand, please. Do you hereby declare and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you are about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth? Thank you. Okay. Say your name, please, and your address.
Yong Ha Kim, 1605 Thomas Road, Pine Point, Maryland, 20674.
Okay, please have a seat. Ma'am, are you going to testify?
I'm just a translator in case he doesn't understand.
Jim, do we need that?
Are you a certified translator or just helping out?
Just helping out.
Yes, okay.
Name and address.
If you wouldn't mind, name and address for the record.
Byung Hee Nam, 43755 Low Pine Way, California, Maryland, 20619.
Thank you. If you would, please have a seat up front. Mr. Kim,
yes.
Thank you. Hopefully you can help me out here. Based on the violation as read, do you admit or deny the violation?
그거 지금 deny 할 거예요. Accept 하냐 아니라 아니라 그래야지.
Deny
아니라는 거. Accept은 너네가 한 말이 맞다는 거.
No.
Deny.
Deny the violation. Yeah. Okay.
If we could have Corporal Stone come up and be sworn in.
You have to swear in.
You hereby declare and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you're about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth.
I do.
Thank you. State your name, please.
I'm Corporal James Stern, St. Mary's County Sheriff's Office, currently in Patrol Division, Squad 1B.
Corporal, you investigated this case as far as serving an intoxicated person at St. Mary's Fine Wine and Spirits located in Great Mills, Maryland.
Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
And could you tell us what your investigation, what you did?
Yeah, so on January 17th at about 1:30 in the afternoon, I responded to an emergency assistant call for someone that was unconscious outside the premise of St. Mary's Fine Wine and Spirits. When I arrived on scene, I observed the injured subject, who was identified as Oliver Malone, who was unconscious down the stairwell on the sidewalk adjacent to the business. When I made contact with the individual, he was breathing, however, could detect a strong odor of alcohol coming from his breath as well as his person. Also visible was a Burdett's vodka half pint laid on the ground next to him with a brown paper bag.
Okay. What did you do?
When I observed the paper bag, obviously called for an ambulance to come and help treat the subject.
Let me stop you right there. Can Can you guys follow this, or?
Yeah, he need to, I need to explain to him what he was saying.
Okay, you want him to slow down a little bit?
Can you go back and, when you were asking, denying and accept part?
Yes.
Are you, is he supposed to say yes to the selling, or the, telling that he was drunk or not drunk part? Because he did sell it. That's the, if that answer is the deny is the right answer.
I think it's still, the violation is for serving a person who was intoxicated.
Right, that's part is denying part, okay.
Okay.
All right, and then, yeah, 저 사람이 지금 그날에 있었던 얘기를 그 옆에서 스테어에서 넘어졌고, 그 옆에서 가게에서 사갖고 마셨다, 그래갖고 병원 불렀다, 뭐 이렇게 얘기해 준 거예요.
그렇죠.
Okay.
Are you okay so far with what his?
Yes.
Okay.
Going forward, I'll slow it down and wait till you guys advise me to continue.
Okay. So, yes, if you could continue, Corporal Stone, what did you do next after you found this individual laying in the stairwell
so
next
we,
to your business?
We contacted an ambulance to come to treat the subject who was unconscious. There was a witness who called 911. His name was John Anthony Mason. Mr. Mason said that the subject was shouting at people going by, began shouting at Mr. Mason. He was visibly intoxicated, swaying, slurred speech when he was doing that, and he shouted at Mr. Mason, called him a bitch, and then at that point, Mr. Malone lost his balance, fell down three steps, landed on the ground, and was knocked unconscious from the fall.
All right, hold on, Mr. Mason. We'll get to you.
Okay, so suddenly,
so what did you do with the individual, Mr. Malone? What did you, ambulance came?
Ambulance came. While the ambulance came, I took the pitch photographs of the vodka, Burnett's vodka bottle in the paper bag, went inside to the business to see if it matches the item that he possessed, which it did. At which time I made contact with the female who was working behind the counter. Her name is Eun-hee Kim.
Okay.
Ms. Kim, I asked her if she had served anybody that matched his description. She said that she said she's not sure. I said, well, come outside with me. I walked her outside, pointed to the subject, and she said yes, she had just sold him a bottle of vodka.
Did she say how long it had been since she had sold him the vodka?
Probably 20 to 30 minutes. She's 30 minutes ago, she said.
Okay.
Yeah, 30 minutes ago.
So what did you do next?
So went back, asked her if there had any video surveillance of the interior or exterior of the business. She says they do. She didn't have the ability to get that video. However, she contacted, I believe it was her husband or the owner, to see about retaining that video. For the assistance of my investigation.
Did you question her about her observations of Mr. Malone when he came in?
Yes. I asked her, and her reply was, I smell no alcohol, and he walked fine, is how she said it to me.
Okay. And did you eventually obtain the video of the transaction that you
I did. The following day, received a phone call that they had gotten the video. So I stopped by, picked up the video, and viewed it on my computer.
Okay.
But going back to Mr. Malone, while he's unconscious on the ground, I administered a PBT on him. I did not do a direct sample where having him wrap his lips around the straw. I just took the PBT device, stuck it over his mouth, and got residual breath. And with him simply breathing like that, it resulted in a 0.134 BAC reading, which is still high, but if it was a direct sample, it would have been much higher than that.
Well, he was taken to the hospital, correct?
He was taken to the hospital, yes.
And did the hospital give him
They did a analysis on him, and later on found out that he was at a 0.40 blood alcohol content.
While at the hospital?
While at the hospital.
Okay. And can you kind of explain the significance of that level of
Well, through training that I've received in the past, there's different levels of intoxication. Obviously, the most common known blood alcohol content that people refer to is 0.08 for DUI, as a threshold between a DWI and DUI. Beyond that, the person becomes more severely intoxicated. So if you multiply 0.08 times whatever it is to get to 0.40, is very, very heavily intoxicated to the point of unconsciousness, which what Mr. Malone was at that point. So, I mean, 0.40 is unconscious or near death,
okay,
is the best way to describe that.
So you observed the video, correct,
yes,
of the transaction of Mr. Malone coming in?
Yes.
Okay. And I believe we've queued that up and it's ready to go. And while they're queuing that up, you've observed the video. What did you observe about the video?
The video has Mr. Malone walking from the way the business is set up off is Point Lookout Road. There's Willie's Towing, St. Mary's Fine Wine and Spirit, and a parking lot beyond that. The area that Mr. Malone walked up to the business, he staggered to the business down the sidewalk into the business. He was disheveled. His hair was a mess. He had trouble maintaining his balance as he was walking, so instead of walking a straight line, you could see him kind of swaying as he's walking up to the business. When he got there to make the purchase, he had trouble with his money. He had to set it on the counter in order to try to complete the sale. He leaned against the counter for balance, and at which point after the sale was completed, he stumbled back out of the business. Prior to playing the video also, I took photographs of Mr. Malone. It has the picture of the vodka bottle, the PBT reading that I took a photograph with my camera, and then also has a picture of Mr. Malone in the position that I found him in when he was passed out. So
those pictures are taken at the scene when you found him?
Okay. Some have passed it for the board to be able to see and also pass it. So
right. If you could show it to the licensee first.
You also sample that number?
Yeah. Okay. With the photographs, you can see that it is the same individual that entered the store when you do watch
give
video.
It to the chair guardian.
Thank you, sir.
With the photograph that was taken, you'll see that it's the same individual that walked into the store prior to the emergency call that we're dispatched for.
Was Mr. Malone able to communicate at all with you?
No. I mean, he was in the hospital unconscious for an extended period of time. When I went to the hospital, he doesn't remember falling down. He admitted to being an alcoholic and admitted to drinking prior to going to that business. I talked to Mr. Malone's sponsor on the telephone, who sponsors him through AA, and he said in the morning when he woke up that Mr. Malone had somehow accessed alcohol, and that prior to him entering that business, his sponsor dropped him off at Great Mill Sheets, where he told him to go up to the Mission or somewhere else to try to get some assistance. He had a family member at the house, his sponsor did, and he did not want Mr. Malone to stay at home, the same place where the guy's niece was. But it also confirmed my suspicion of how impaired the individual was. And again, the way that the sponsor described him was extremely intoxicated, slurred speech, unsafe.
Okay. Will the video show on the television screens too, or just on the?
That I don't know. Do you want to ask?
She's
got it up. Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Has everyone had a chance to see the video, pictures?
Oh, the pictures.
All right, if we could play that now, and if you could describe as what we're seeing as it comes up.
So this is the front of the business, the sidewalk. You see Mr. Malone walking towards the business. You see he has trouble walking as he's walking up. He's not walking in much of a straight line. As he walks into the business, the camera view is going to switch. This is him walking into the business. Walking with a purpose to the counter to make contact with Ms. Kim. You see how disheveled he looks. He asked her for vodka. He has money clutched in his hands. And this is at the point where he goes to start counting the money for the alcohol or liquor. The slow deliberate movements are indicators of someone that might be impaired and things to look for. You see the slow movements as he's passing off the money for the alcohol. The position that he was with her at that given time, is, and the odor of alcohol that was detected off him, I believe, is more than enough for her to recognize and his mannerisms. And he takes it and he walks away stumbling. And then he walked outside, went to the side of the building where he consumed the vodka beverage on that stairwell outside the business.
Okay, and that is the business of St. Mary's Fine Wine and Spirits that we're talking about?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and that was Mr. Malone, the individual you described that you found that day?
That was.
Okay, anything else as part of your investigation?
Mr. Malone is a habitual alcoholic. He's been arrested or cited at numerous places in the past throughout the public of St. Mary's County. Within this interaction with him, it raised a huge concern, at which point I followed up with him and had him emergency evaluated to make sure he's of sound mind and tried to get him treatment, at which point a couple days after this incident was able to get him into a treatment program, which I'm not sure if he's following through with or not, but
Based on your experience as a police officer and your observations of Mr. Malone when you came upon him and viewing this video, is your opinion that he was intoxicated before he walked in that store?
Absolutely.
That's all the questions I have. Do you have any questions? I'm asking the licensee if they have any questions before we turn it over to the board for questions.
He thought he was a handicapped, not being drunk, and he was just walking slow. He doesn't look like a staggering his alcohol.
Do you have any questions for Corporal Stone?
No.
No, okay. Mr. Chairman, does the board have any questions?
Okay. How long have you been an officer?
I've been with law enforcement officer since 2005, July 2005, so 12 years, give or take.
You were the alcohol enforcement coordinator for how long?
Approximately 8 years, 7.5 to 8 years.
If you were to come upon somebody who was a 4-0, would that require hospitalization on its own?
Yes.
Were there any injuries present that showed or indicated that he did fall down the steps, or did he simply slump there?
He fell down the step. He did not have any injuries visible on his face. However, the position that he fell to is where he remained the entire time until fire EMS responded. But again, the odor of alcohol that was emitting off of him during initial contact, I mean, I could smell him within 4 feet of making contact with him.
The bottle and bag were found under the step?
The bag was under the step and the bottle was right next to him on the railing.
Okay. But no head injuries, anything consistent with falling down the steps?
No.
Sold 30 minutes prior, do we know that he was out there sitting on the steps?
The alcohol, the liquor bottle and the bag was where he was at the given time. The witness saw him and called 911 when he made the fall.
And I'm assuming from the photo that that bottle is empty?
Yeah.
Within 30 minutes?
Yes.
What size was it?
I believe it was a 20 milliliter. So it's a quarter pint, I believe what it was.
That was right.
Say the bottle was half empty or full empty?
It was empty. It was empty. I mean, there's maybe a drop left, but he'd have to hold it over his mouth for a long time to eat that.
Back to the sponsor. Sponsor dropped him off at what time?
Dropped him off just prior to him making his way to that business. So I believe it would have been around 1 o'clock.
And the sponsor's opinion?
Was he was severely intoxicated.
The sponsor's words on who the subject, on his condition?
The sponsor's word was that he was extremely intoxicated and unsafe, is how he described it to me.
So, Corporal Stone, the subject had made it across Route 5 from Sheets, I assume?
That's correct. He walked across Point Lookout Road, which is a heavy intersection at the corner of Great Mills Road, and made his way to St. Mary's Fine Wine and Spirits.
And then he had consumed a pint of vodka in 30 minutes?
Yes. From the time that he purchased it to however long it took him to consume it to when I finally made contact with him, it was consumed. I think the video, I can't recall the timestamp on the video, but the video has a timestamp at 1:15, so he downed that pint of vodka pretty quick within 15 minutes prior to us getting there, so.
Is it possible someone could have spilled when he fell?
No, the bottle was upright on the railing. Right. So it was consumed and the bottle was left there. So probably could have charged him with littering too.
And Mr. Mason was still at the scene when you got there?
Mr. Mason was there. I had him as a witness. Mr. Mason just called as a good Samaritan. He indicated that he did not want to be involved in any type of legal proceedings, but because of him being there witnessing it, I just added him as a witness for the situation that occurred.
Anything else for Corporal Stone?
How did the hospital then ascertain a 0.4 reading?
They do a blood sample when they have them there. They draw blood and then they send it for analysis. Okay. And the analysis came back. And the reason why I had that reading from that is I didn't subpoena the blood analysis, but Mr. Malone had escaped from the hospital where he went to Gunther's Fine Wine and Spirits and got more alcohol to drink and passed out in front of that business. So both of these
was
calls.
Was that incident after this one?
Yeah.
Okay. Yep.
So, but the hospital called and said and gave us the information that Mr. Malone had left, that he was a 0.40 BAC level or blood alcohol level from what they did, and that they're really concerned for his safety. And, you know, it really is a dangerous situation for everybody, and he could have been hit by a car. He could have killed himself falling down the steps. He could have injured somebody else not knowing what he was doing due to his alcoholism.
Corporal, have you ever seen Mr. Malone sober?
Yeah, in the hospital after he detoxed.
Well, have you seen him when he's sober and walking around?
Yeah.
And
normal as could be. He's actually a really nice guy.
So based on your observation when he's sober, how would you compare that to the observations on the video of how he was walking?
Night and day. Night and day. When he walks normal. When he talks fluently, steadily. When he was heavily intoxicated, he tends to not say much, smile, frown, it's sad to see him in the state that he was when he's intoxicated, but it was good to see him that he's trying. So,
I guess my point is, though, when you, on the video, the observations of how he was walking and conducting himself as he walked in that to the store.
I mean, all those things we teach, or the alcohol board teaches, and at the time I assisted in teaching RAS training, which is responsible alcohol service training, and we talk about impaired individuals, signs of alcoholism, signs of possibly not making a sale, and reasons why you can refuse to make sales. And the majority of the indications that you saw within that video are all indicators of things that would make you want to not make that sale, you know? And we teach lots of licensees these things. And sometimes people do drink before they go to get more alcohol. And sometimes people don't show visible signs of being impaired by alcohol. But in this situation, he definitely, in my opinion, not even, if I couldn't smell alcohol on him watching the video and never having any type of interaction with him after that fact, watching the video itself, if someone showed me that video through my training experiences, I would say that person it was most likely intoxicated or impaired.
Certainly, there could have been more investigation in the store about what his state was.
Yes.
Okay, anything else from the board?
Not for me. No. Okay. Thank you, Corporal.
Mr. Mason,
yes, sir.
Do you wish to testify?
If y'all need me,
well,
sir.
Why don't you come up? We'll see what you have to say.
Okay.
Sir, if you give your name and address for the record.
Can I give us one?
Mason.
Yes, please. Do you hereby declare under the penalty and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you're about to give is true?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. I'll give your name.
Okay. Name and address.
John Mason, Post Office Block 1453, Lexington Park.
Okay. You saw that video?
Yeah, I saw that video.
Do you? And you were there that day when you when Mr.
Yeah,
Malone came?
Yeah.
What did you observe about him?
I just came out the house on top of the step smoking.
On top of where?
I was on top of the step. I came out. I live upstairs.
Okay.
And he came around the corner. And he sat on the step, and he turned around and asked me, "Do I got 50 cents?" I said, "No, I ain't got no 50 cents." And he said, "No, ain't none of you bitches around here got 50 cents." So he sat on the step. I ain't even see him with the bottle, to be honest with you. I ain't see it until the cops came here.
Mm-hmm.
And they dumped it out. And he was sitting on the step, and all of a sudden, he was sitting there and he just went boom, hit the ground real hard. I said, "This fool would knock his ass out." So I stood there for a minute to see if he'd move. So he didn't move. So I dialed 911. Somebody would come get him because he fell out. And I said, "Now this is a bitch. He just got for knocking himself out." And
had you seen Mr. Malone before?
I seen him before around there, yeah.
Okay.
But he walked like he got a handicapped lift mm-hmm. all the time. When he walked, he like something wrong with his legs or something. Yeah, he had a limp to him. But that ain't the first time I could see him.
And
but I didn't even know he was drunk. But they say he was drunk.
You didn't have enough close up contact with him?
No. I was upstairs and he was downstairs when he asked me for that 50 cent.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Mason.
And then he started cussing me out.
Do you have any idea why?
Huh?
Why did he start cussing you out?
Because I wouldn't give him 50 cents.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Hold on.
Oh,
does anyone have any questions for Mr. Mason?
No.
Does the licensee have any questions for Mr. Mason?
No.
No? Okay.
But he didn't appear to be drunk. That's the way he walked. He got a limp.
Okay.
He got a limp when he walked.
Thank you, Mr. Mason.
Okay. That's it?
That's it?
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. That's all the evidence presenting. Does the licensee have any evidence they'd like to present?
Because Mr. Malone, he never, I mean, this is the first time he bought a liquor from that store.
Does he wish to testify?
Malone,
그 봤을 때 정상적으로 봤을 때 몸만 좀 흔들렸지 그 술 먹은 사람으로 봤지 않았기, 보지 않았기 때문에 우리가 하는 거고
Yeah, it was the first time he came to buy the liquor from that store and he's seen many people walk slow so he thought it was just physically handicapped, you know.
Was Mr. Kim there that day?
No, his wife said okay. that to him.
Okay.
And his wife told me too.
Okay, so this is coming from?
His wife.
His wife through Mr.
To,
Kim.
Yeah, okay. Kim and she told me as well. Because okay. he looked, you know, he didn't smell drinking.
Does Mr. Kim have anything else he wants to testify about?
No.
Does he have any witnesses?
Does he? No, sir.
Good.
딴 사람 저기 증인으로 내세울 사람 없죠?
그런 건 없고 어떤 때간에 그 사람이 사고가 나서 네. 사고 나서 상당히 미안하고 미안하게 생각하고.
Right. Just because he had an accident, he feels he's sorry for him.
그 술 3불짜리 3불이거든 들이 나는데 yeah. 그걸 팔아서 돈을 많이 벌으려고 술 취한 yeah. 사람한테 팔거나 그러진 않는다.
Yeah.
지금까지
okay.
20년 동안
And that vodka was only $3 worth. It's not worth him to. Risk his license to sell just one bottle to a drunken person. So it's not in at his conscience to sell a liquor, just one bottle to a drunken person. That's his conscience. So he's saying he, yeah, that's what he'd like to say.
Okay, so I think we have all the testimony is finished. And is there anything else Mr. Kim would like to say before the board starts? Well, I guess, does the board have any questions for Mr. Kim?
My question is, Mr. Kim, this was your wife that sold the alcohol, correct?
Wife가 파는 거죠. 네.
And it's just Mr. Kim and his wife who work at the store. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yes.
Has your wife taken RAST training?
Alcohol training 받았어요?
오래 전에 받았고 5년이 넘었어. 나만 받았지 내가.
Okay. About 5 years ago.
About 5 years ago.
And the most recent one he only took.
He Mr. Kim
yeah,
also has attended RAST?
He came to last month's RAST.
Yeah. Last month.
The very last one, yeah.
Mr. Kim, how long have you had the liquor store?
I'm sorry?
How long has he had the liquor store?
The liquor store?
10 years.
About 10 years.
Is this the first violation?
Well, we haven't got that far yet. We're just talking about the evidence right now.
Okay.
And if there's any questions regarding the testimony or the video we've heard okay. so far, or if Mr. Kim has any other statements he'd like to make. Is there anything else Mr. Kim would like to say about the evidence?
Nothing special.
Okay. So I think we've finished the evidence, and now the board can take up.
We'd like to call a recall, Corporal Stone.
Corporal Stone, okay.
Mm-hmm. Corporal Stone, based on Mr. Mason's testimony, were you the first officer on the scene?
Myself, Sergeant Raddatz, and I think Matt Lawrence were the first ones on the scene.
But EMS there before you? EMS there before you?
No, we had to call EMS.
Okay.
So the photograph I took of him, you can see there's no ambulance crew working on him yet. I took a photograph of him laying on the ground.
Right. Could anyone have emptied that bottle? Mr. Mason testified that he observed the officer empty the bottle. I just want to clarify.
No, when we got there, from what I can recall of memory, is Mr. Davis or Mr. Mason was there. We got there within probably a minute after the call went out, and Mr. Malone was on the ground, basically as I can describe him, as a fetal position, face down, with the paper bag with the alcohol and the alcohol bottle on the railing, So, it, I mean,
that's where. So that photo is how it was found?
Yes.
Okay. Also, Mr. Mason testified that the Mr. Malone has a hitch in his step.
Yeah.
Your observation?
No, when I was at the hospital with him, and I drove him to Walden for treatment, and on the way there, I stopped at Wawa and allowed him to get a coffee before he went there, and he walked inside the store with me, and I bought him a coffee, and he walked fine to me. So, it's my observation. Mr. Mason has his own type of observation of what he believes.
Sure, I understand.
I can't.
Did you have a conversation with Mr. Malone? Did he say he had been drinking prior to?
Yes. Yeah. He had told me that he, he cried when he told me, but said he has a problem drinking. He says he can drink the pint of vodka within 30 seconds. He downs it just to help him with his substance abuse problem. And, you know, he told me a lot of things, Mr. Malone did. And, you know, I think the circumstances that occurred was through a majority of a lot of Mr. Malone's own substance abuse issues. But when it boiled down to it and reviewed the whole situation, was that the business was a contributing factor in Mr. Malone accessing that alcohol.
Just to be clear, I think the chairman's question was, did he tell you he'd been drinking before he got to the liquor store?
Yes. Yeah, he told me that. He also gave me the number to his sponsor through AA, at which point that's when I made contact with the sponsor, and the sponsor confirmed that.
For me real quick. Did he reach out to the sponsor, and then or did he arrive at the sponsor's home and the sponsor said, I don't feel you're unsafe?
The sponsor was allowing him to stay there temporarily because he's homeless. The sponsor had family in town staying with him. He said when he went to sleep the night before that Mr. Malone was sober. He said when he woke up in the morning time, somehow Mr. Malone accessed alcohol and was back at the residence. And he said that he did not want Mr. Malone there at the residence because he had to go to work and his niece was there who was young and did not want to leave Mr. Malone at the residence with his niece. That's when he drove him to Great Mills, the corner of Great Mills Road and Point Lookout Road, dropped him off at the Sheets, gave him instructions to go up to the Mission or somewhere else for the day, and Mr. Malone chose to go over to the liquor store instead and continue his rampage on drinking.
Okay. Any other questions?
Over the years, how many times have you had meetings with Mr. Malone while he's been intoxicated?
Really, that's the first time I ever came in contact with Mr. Malone. And within that single day, I dealt with him later on that night at Gunther's Fine Wine and Spirits. The following morning, I contacted the hospital to see if they had kept him or released him. They kept him. I went back to the hospital on my day off and talked with him some more. It took several days for him to finally get inpatient treatment, but they had to wait for a bed to be made for him. And he's been intoxicated again. He's been arrested in Leonardtown over by Taco Bell prior to this event. Unknowns to me, but he had passed out at the Taco Bell 2 days previously in front of Point Lookout Road and Newtown Neck Road. If you give me a chance to look at my report, I can tell you the times prior to it, but he's been found intoxicated, passed out three times prior to this incident within 3 days. And so it was becoming a habitual problem. But he's been arrested several times since then. He continues to try to go to treatment. When he's not drinking, Mr. Malone is actually a funny guy. And, I just really, when it comes to this, is keeping citizens safe, keeping the public safe, and not providing alcohol to people who should not be provided alcohol at the given time is really what this boils down to.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Kim, do you have any questions of Corporal Stone?
No,
No, thank you.
Okay, I think that's the end of the evidence, and it's ready for the board to take up any motions the board wants to make.
Okay.
Right, I think it has to make a motion.
What's that?
Right, the first thing you have to determine is whether a violation occurred.
What do we think, folks?
Does that have to be a motion?
Well, I think you can make a motion one way or the other, and then second it, and then have discussion, and then vote on.
Yeah, we just need a motion as to which way we think we're going, and then discuss it after the decision.
Your penalty motion, if you felt would be a separate motion, right. If you felt the incident occurred.
We need a verdict motion first.
I make a motion that given the testimony of Corporal Stone, the video, store video that we saw also, that there is a violation of Section 6-307 of the Alcohol Beverage Articles of the Annotated Code of Maryland and Section 5.04, the rules of the regulations of the Alcohol Beverage Board of St. Mary's, that there was a violation that did occur January 17th, 2017 at St. Mary's Fine Wine and Spirits in Great Mills, Maryland.
Do we have a second?
I second.
Okay.
Discussion.
Yep. So what do we think, folks? This is a difficult one. What do you think? Based on my years in law enforcement, the video tells me he was intoxicated before he walked in.
I think with the evidence we have to be.
If I could just ask the board to speak up, since this is a public hearing. So that
sure. Yeah, I think with the evidence in the video, and I think he was intoxicated before he went in the store.
Unfortunately, Mr. Kim testified to the fact that he felt or his wife, who's not present, that we can't interview, correct? His wife is the seller.
She was the seller, right. Mr. Kim was not present during the transaction, and he's gathered some information from talking to her.
Sure. So I understand his response where she felt that he was handicapped. At some point, though, you have to alert to the RAS training to say, is this individual intoxicated or not? Why are they acting in this manner?
Well, he definitely looked intoxicated to me, plus his blood levels. Look how high they were once they got to the hospital. That just didn't occur from him laying on the ground.
Well, the 20 milliliters, what would that bring him to is my concern. When was the blood test? And I don't.
Well, he had before he went in there.
That's correct. I understand how Corporal Stone got the PBT reading, but he did not get a full breath sample at the time. And what would that have read? Because the individual would not have metabolized a pint in such a short time frame. We also have testimony on that the sponsor observed the individual intoxicated, but the sponsor's not here to give us that testimony. We have it from Corporal Stone that he was intoxicated prior to walking in. And based on the motor movements the action on the video, it's clear that he's under the influence of something. At what level, we can't tell that. Anyone else in the discussion? I'm just trying to verbalize out here as to... You have a huge responsibility when it comes to serving alcohol.
I think you can ask for a vote.
Yeah? Do we have a vote? All in favor of the motion as it stands?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion carried. Violation occurred. Now, to the penalty phase. We need a motion on what we believe is a fair penalty.
Anything prior, Tammy?
No, sir.
In business for 10 years, no prior violations. Do we have a motion as to the penalty?
I'll make a motion that we fine the St. Mary's Fine Wine and Spirits, Young Ha Kim, $500, $250 of it suspended for the sale of alcohol beverage to an intoxicated person in violation of 6-307 of the alcohol beverage article of the Anadota Code of Maryland in 504I of the rules and regs of the Alcohol Beverage Board of St. Mary's County.
Do you have a second? I second it. All those in favor?
Discussion.
Any discussion? What are we thinking, folks? It's okay to have a discussion.
We just had one of these a couple months ago, and that's pretty much what we did a couple
months
ago.
That's right.
I would also like to see a recertification of RAS training.
Well, he's been, so he's
but
the one
for
on
his
license.
Wife.
But he,
but
he's,
it was the
he's
wife.
The one on the license, though. That's,
yeah.
She's
can,
not on the
can,
license.
Can. You can make the suggestion, but you can't oppose, and I'm not sure how Mrs. Kim's English is, but I think if she came, maybe with an interpreter. And they're one of them. I've talked to Mr. Kim. They can't both come to the training at one time.
He's willing to send her.
Yeah, and he had told me that he was going to.
Okay.
So.
Yeah.
I think that's a good idea. Truly. Thank you, Mr.
But
Cole.
I don't think
yes.
you can put that in your penalty. Since she's
that
not
can't
a
be part of...
Not, since she's not a licensee, no.
Sure. Any further discussion on the penalty? Any thoughts, Ms. Palczynski?
Well, let me jump in here. I'm not sure I agree. I think you can put that as a condition for the licensee. If obviously Ms. Kim is going to continue working there, that I think you can put that as a condition that she will complete the RAS training.
Because I thought with the new rules we had moved into where we could hold the
That was for... underage service, though.
Right. I mean, you are penalizing the licensee by saying that in order.
She'll go. I mean, she'll definitely go. No problem with that.
Worker at this place, my business. She will get this training. I think that can be done.
Sure. Okay. I think we have their compliance. Do we have a vote on the motion? Or do we have a second on the penalty motion?
You seconded.
We already seconded.
Already seconded, okay.
So we have a motion, so vote.
Vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? None. Motion carries. Mr. Kim, you have 10 days in which to pay the violation. You have 30 days in which to appeal. The violation to you at this point is $250 within 10 days. $250 is being held in abeyance pending no further violations for 3 years. Tammy will take care of that.
So the penalty is $250 within
payable 10 within 10 days, yes, ma'am.
Within 10 days.
Yep. The other $250, the entire penalty was $500. $250 was put in abeyance and suspension basically for 3 years.
Okay. And when is the rest of the $250?
It sits off and it does not get assessed to you. You do not pay it unless you have another violation of the alcohol beverage license within 3 years.
So if he doesn't have, it doesn't violate within the next 3 years, he doesn't have to pay
yep.
another.
That's correct. That's correct. Okay.
Yes.
Y'all have a good day. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming in.
Mr. Kim. Come to my office next week and I'll help you. Next week. Okay.
They should have a lawyer when they come in.
Yes. I agree with you. All right, so we're not discussing the other one. We're going back to now. We're going to applications.
Yes.
On the next list is Stoney's at Clark's Landing, application of Eugene Cousineau, Louis Stone, Charles Clark to purchase a Class B restaurant BWL license and trade as Stoney's at Clark's Landing at Stoney's at Clark's Landing LLC, 24580 Clark's Landing Lane, Hollywood, Maryland 20636. Also requesting catering privilege and permission for extension of premise for outdoor service, use of two exterior walk-in boxes and one storage shed. Folks.
Please raise your right hand, please. Do you hereby declare and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you're about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth? Thank you. State your name and address, please.
160 Bamboo Shea Lane, Solomons, Maryland, 20615.
Thank you.
Louis P. Stone, 160 Bamboo Shea Lane, down Maryland. Thank you.
Charles Clark, 24550 Clark's Landing Lane, Hollywood.
Thank you. If you all would come up and have a seat. Good afternoon. Thank you for coming in. If you would explain your application.
To operate a restaurant, bar, indoor-outdoor seating at the location of 24580 Clark's Landing Lane, Hollywood, Maryland.
Have any of you three held a alcohol license before?
Yes. I have one in Calvert County, and so does my husband.
Okay. Tammy, anything we need to know?
No. Ms. Cousineau just gave me the fire marshal, her occupancy, and is there a trader's license in there?
Yes, I gave you the receipt for it.
Okay. Did you do the personal property yet?
It's right there. That's the receipt for you as well,
okay.
Right there.
Okay, but do you have your, okay.
The receipt's right there.
She's got it. She's making copies for me. I'm sorry. I don't have them in front of me. But did you have a copy of the last year's traders? You know, your current one.
Yes.
It expires. Sorry. They all will need to do RAST, as we don't have any of them. And I believe we have the alcohol awareness from when they have a license. Thank you. I'll get it back to you. Okay.
Based on response 24, you both had a Class B in Solomon's for 10 years to present?
30 years for him, 12 years for me now.
That's not what I'm seeing here.
Look in the back. Are you looking at the back of the application?
Number 24?
Yeah, 20, yeah. Yes.
Who held it? Mr. Clark. And then...
This is Mr. Clark.
Yeah, but...
That was 23 years ago.
Not under the same ownership, obviously.
But who's number?
Number 3 is the question. That there, 24 is the explanation for question number 3,
right.
Is what they have here? Yeah.
That's what I'm getting
but
at.
But who is... Is it Gene and Phil Stone?
Regina and Phil Stone, yes.
Regina?
No. That's the licensees. Common names that they go by versus Eugenia and Lewis.
Okay.
Eugenia
okay.
goes by Jeannie, Lewis goes by Phil.
Okay, got it.
Okay, sorry.
And that's approximately 10 years to present now.
He's had one for 30 years and I've had one for 12.
Okay, yeah, that's what's throwing me off.
But that's now for Stoney's and Solomon's?
That's
or
yes,
Kingfisher?
Stoney's, Brooms, Allen. I have Stoney's, Kingfisher's.
And you've got Kingfisher?
I have Kingfisher.
Stoney's, Brooms,
Stoney's, Brooms, Allen.
Okay.
The Casinos had the liquor license at Stoney's. They missed the renewal deadline date. So, of course, if you don't renew in St. Mary's County, your license dies at the end of April. If you wait until the end of April to reapply, you wouldn't be before the board until the June meeting, the way the deadline days go. So in order to limit their amount of time not being able to serve alcohol, they canceled their license on deadline
day
and reapplied and submitted their application.
That's what was throwing me off. I knew it was an operation.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
I'm thinking to myself, I know where it's, you know, quick landing.
So, sorry.
Right. Okay.
Right. I figured I needed to jump
in. Tamara was nice enough. Yeah. She helped me get it taken care of within a week so that we could get on this hearing.
Okay. All right. So it's already been in place.
Yes, sir.
And it's just simply renewal.
Okay.
It happens.
I'm with it. It was throwing me for a loop. Mm-hmm. Really, and no other questions. Really, you've been in operation. There's been no issue there.
Right.
Simply renewal.
What's the seating capacity at in Hollywood?
I believe it's 188.
188.
I handed her the. I don't.
Okay. I think it's like 190 or something.
Somewhere that.
Wow.
Yes.
Wow. About right.
So it is large. It's large operation.
But some of it's outside dining.
Right. The two of you will then hold the license.
No, Mr. Clark will hold the license. He's a partner.
Clark will hold the license.
Right.
It's all three. Mr. Clark carries the residency.
Sure. Okay.
It's a restaurant. If I'm going to guess at what you're referring at. It's a restaurant, and in the state of Maryland, you can be on multiple restaurant licenses, one per county.
One per county.
Correct.
Who then will manage Stoney's? I mean, it's not going to be.
For sure.
We do everyday operations as well, but my general manager is Safira Reinhardt. She's TIPS and TAM certified.
Okay.
Sorry for the confusion. I just want to ensure, is there anything new or additional that you're trying to add at this stage?
No, we updated any questions that Ms. Hildebrandt had. There was a walk-in that was, we had an addition to it before, but we made sure it was on the plan and everything. It had been already added, but it's on the full drawing and everything now.
Okay. Any further questions?
Just the outdoor services for that patio area?
Correct.
Outside? Right.
Any further questions?
No, it all stays the same from the last
time. Right, as long as it's the same. A motion?
Oh, I make a motion for the approval of Stoney's at Clark's Landing application of Eugenia Kosinox, Louis P. Stone III, and Charles F. Clark to purchase a Class B restaurant BWL license and trading as Stoney's at Clark's Landing, Stoney at Clark's Landing LLC, 24580 Clark's Landing Road, Hollywood, Maryland, 20636. Also requesting catering privilege and permission for extension of premise for outdoor service, use of two exterior walk-in boxes and one storage shed.
Thank you. Do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you all. Sorry for the confusion.
Hopefully I'll be able to
hang on for okay. Your originals.
I would like to get the license today if it's possible, since I booked an 85th birthday party on Sunday.
I know. I'm going to do the best I can during the meeting and get it to you.
Should I just wait for your call and then meet you at the
please.
Office?
Please.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next on the business, St. Mary's Gas Station, application of Kim Po Sao to purchase a Class A1 BWL license and trade as St. Mary's Gas Station, St. Mary's Gas Station LLC, 23950 Colton Point Road, Clements, Maryland, 20624. Sir?
Yes, please raise your right hand, both of you, please. Do you hereby declare and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you are about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth? Thank you. Please state your name and address.
My name is Kim Seo, address 23950 Cotton Point Road, Clement, Maryland, 20624.
Are you going to be testifying, sir?
Well, I'm just going to be here to help him translate. I'm not a professional translator or whatever. I'm just Kim asked me to come over and explain some things for him as well.
That, sure. That wasn't his home address he just gave them, that was address of the building.
Okay, ask for the home address.
Yeah, your home address.
My home address, 23415, Kenaco, California, Maryland, 20619.
Good catch, Mr. Hall. Mm-hmm. If you would, name the address.
My name is Donald Birch, 26997 Falkirk Drive, Mechanicsville, Maryland.
Thank you, sir. If you would, have a seat. How do you pronounce your last name?
Sal.
Sal.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. I didn't want to butcher. What else can you tell us, Mr. Sal, based on your application?
What can I tell
you? Why are you here?
Yeah, I tried to apply for get a legal license in my store. Yeah.
How long have you owned the store?
Actually, it's 3 years.
What's the A1 BWL, Dan?
A1 BWL is a package store with beer, wine, and spirit liquor privilege. Off sale only. And in Mr. Sow's case, it will be, if he is granted this license, it will be the last Class A license for District 7, voting District 7, because they will be at max quota.
Oh, really?
Yeah, our Class A's have quotas.
How many for District 7?
I don't know offhand. I think it's only two, and he would be the second one, okay. if I remember. Yeah, I didn't bring that with me, but I think it's only two right now. It goes by population, so if the population happens to increase in the 7th district, then there would be an opening for another.
This is across the road from Anderson's?
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay. On the corner right there.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it already serving?
Sorry.
Isn't it already serving?
I
thought there was a liquor.
Anderson's does. Anderson's.
Across from Anderson's when
it's the gas station.
Circle.
Yeah, what was the gentleman's
there was
name?
Another one there. Hurry Store.
Hurry Store used to be a
used to have one, right? But they're closed.
Okay. That's what I was thinking. Okay.
Okay, so Hurry Store looks like this place is right.
It's the gas station right on the corner. Yes.
Jimmy's out about it.
Yeah.
That was Norman. Norman had it. I thought he had it. Norman Pilkerton. Didn't Norman Pilkerton own it? I thought he had beer and
Pilkerton
wine.
Pilkerton had his shop out of there prior to
to the
opening up as a store.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Anyone have
Chairman,
any
if I may,
yes, sir.
Our company, Virtual Company, subleases to Kim.
Okay.
The site. We lease the site from Phil Hurry. And it's a gas station with a, used to have garage, two-bay garage or three-bay. And Jeff Pilkerton was running it one time. And there were a couple occupants after Jeff, and then Mr. Kim came in, and we've been leasing it to him for going on the fourth year now.
Okay.
And he has taken the bays and converted it to a convenience store.
Okay.
And now he'd like to have a sell liquor there, or beer and wine.
Okay. So it'll still be a gas station?
Yes, sir.
No service?
No mechanic work. No
mechanical right. service and everything. What hours, what days of the week, hours?
Hour is 7 to 8:30, 7 days a week.
You're going through a pretty trying time with all the construction right there at this stage. A couple of holes in your driveway. I don't know why I thought that was beer and wine already.
Did you say Anderson's Bar is across the street from this?
Yes.
Yes. Anyone have any questions?
Kim, did the fire marshal come out and contact you?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, because I didn't get anything back from
the past, they gave me the paper, okay. And they say they're going to email you.
Okay, if you do approve it, it's conditional on the fire marshal inspection.
And that's already been done, correct?
I'm sorry?
That's already been done?
That's what he's saying, I just haven't received anything back from the fire marshal.
Okay.
Yeah.
I can bring to you.
That's fine, huh?
Were there any protests or anything?
Not written or, yeah, not written in the office. No, I don't know about.
Yeah, really don't have any questions. Is there any opposition or support from the audience to this application? Having heard none. What are our thoughts? Want to make a motion?
I'll make a motion that we approve the application of Kim Poso to purchase Class A BWL license and trade as St. Mary's Gas Station, St. Mary's Gas Station LLC, 23950 Colton Point Road, Clements, Maryland 20624.
Thank you, Mr. Cole. Do we have a second?
Wait a second. I thought it was a conditional approval.
It is.
Conditional, yes.
It's conditional approval for a state fire marshal.
And how many days? 30 days. He's already got it, so 30 days minimum.
That's a conditional approval.
Do we have a second?
A second.
Okay. Where are we at, Tammy? Where does this bring us to for licenses for the county? Total licenses.
This would be 165.
And this maxes out District 7?
For Class A package store license, yes.
Okay.
You know why that's going to become a concern, correct?
Be aware, Mr. Sell, that there's no drinking on the premises.
Oh, yeah, I understand. Yeah.
Nobody can go in there with a bag and stand around, watch Keno or anything and drink, because that's a violation.
Yeah, I understand.
Workload, so forth. We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Haven't heard none. Motion carries. Congratulations. Good luck to you.
Thank you.
All right. Take care of yourself.
Thank you.
Kim, bring me the...
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow. The county is closed tomorrow, so Monday, or if you want to wait and see when we get out of here. But you don't have it with you, do you?
I do.
Okay. Then bring it Monday.
Okay.
Everybody see.
Next on the agenda, premise changes, Quaid Store. George Quaid, requesting temporary extension of premise and extra serving county for 6 outdoor music events from May 2017 through December 2017. Ms. Fontinsky.
And for the benefit of the new board members, Mr. Quaid's in every year. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. My apologies.
That's okay. Mr. Quaid, do you hereby declare and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you are about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you. State your name, please.
George L. Quaid III, 36786 Bushwood Wharf Road, Bushwood.
Thank you, sir. Have a seat.
Both Mr. Quaid and the next Ms. Russell, Ms. Draper, for the next are asking for temporary extensions. The older board members know that Mr. Quaid comes in every year. These are conditional. They're multiple events during the summer, and they are conditional upon approval of health and land use growth management special event permit, which Mr. Quaid brings into me prior to each. You know, he'll get me the copies. So just so you know that it is a conditional approval upon those two items.
Okay, conditional for health department. What else?
Land use.
How many years have you been doing, Mr. Quaid?
Well, this is the third year for the music event.
Okay.
Third, full year.
Any issues?
No issues.
All right. Where are you located, Mr. Quaid?
Quaid's is over in Bushwood, about 15 minutes outside Leonardtown.
Where?
You know where Captain Sam's is? Captain Sam's Ballfield?
Okay.
You turn down, go past that.
Go down to the end, all the way down on the water.
All the way down to the water, huh? Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm.
I know what you want to say.
Pretty successful for you.
Yes, this went well. Yeah, well received, I think. Yeah.
No problems with security and all that kind
of stuff? No. We have people there to handle parking and security and the door and all that.
Assuming everybody had this, are there any other questions? Anything you'd like to add, Mr. Quaid?
No, I don't know if I need to do the dates or...
The dates were included in his...
How many can you hold?
Well, it's... the fire marshal actually never put a rating on the outside, since it's an outdoor... That's an outdoor event. We're at 98 inside.
How many do you normally see on a concert date?
It ranges anywhere. We've probably had maybe 250.
250.
And it's more than the average of anywhere between 100 and 200.
Should they state the dates for
this would have come in just under the wire before our team joined the board. So, if you have any further questions, they've seen it a few times. I'm good. I read it all. Yeah.
I'm good.
I reviewed it in the last week. Do we have a motion?
I make a motion to approve the premise changes for Quaid Store. George Quaid requests a temporary extension of premise and have an extra serving counter for 6 outdoor music events from May 2017 to September 2017. Conditional on Nugaman Health.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. Do we have a second?
I second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carried. Good luck to you.
Okay.
Enjoy your summer.
Thank you.
Next order of business is Russell Store, Janet Draper, requesting temporary extension of premise for 4 outdoor wrestling events and 1 car show from May 2017 through September 2017.
Do you hereby declare, and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you're about to give is the truth and nothing but the truth? Thank you. State your name, please, and address. Each one. I can't hear you, please.
You come up. Give her a hand.
Just move it down.
Move it down a little bit.
There you go.
Janet Draper, Russell Store, 44894 Lake Road, Valley Lee, Maryland, 20692.
Thank you.
What's home address?
Yes.
Mr. Draper, your home address? Did you, was that?
Business address.
That's the business address you gave us? We need your home address.
44724 Lake Creek Road, Valley Lee, Maryland.
Thank you.
Roger Buckler the third, 44896 Lake Creek Road, Leonardtown, Maryland, 20650.
Right, have a seat.
We are in possession of your changes or your request. Can you tell us any further? What can you tell us else?
Pardon me?
What else can you tell us about your request?
We want to have, my grandson's an amateur wrestler. We want to have some wrestling shows. Attracts mostly kids, little kids, but the parents have to bring them.
What do you have in place? What type of security practices are you going to have in place for that?
Because
you're bringing in so many, you are going to be bringing in a much younger group.
Yes, and I patrol the premise in between me and my matches. And we have, the ring is roped off to where it's in my front yard, to where they have, you know, everybody who's watching the show stays in the horseshoe pits. And I have security people who watch that to make sure nobody goes in my yard or can come from my yard into the horseshoe pits. And we also have my brother, he walks around to make sure no kids or anything like that is getting into alcohol left around or the trash that's left around is being picked up and stuff like that.
I understand. Let me clarify. My questions for security are maintaining alcohol for 21 and above. How are you going to ensure, because you're going to be bringing in, and I understand completely what you said, you are going to be bringing in parents and their young ones, but you're going to have a lot of teenagers or young adults there. How are you ensuring that they are not drinking alcohol?
I have the security guys on the lookout up here who are by the ring and like the cutoff line of the horseshoe pits in my front yard. And then I have my brother kind of watching the area back here as best as possible, because a lot of them don't even come into the store to buy any sodas or chips or anything like that. They come watch the show, and then they would leave after the show's over with.
We're not going to be selling any alcohol outside. It'll just be strictly from the
bar. Yeah.
Okay,
that's
what I'm trying to get to is basically you're going to be selling alcohol. You're going to have a 22-year-old walk in, grab 2 beers, walk out, my assumption was it was going to be outside. Now you're saying you're not doing that outside. Excellent. But hands it off to somebody. How do we know that person is of age? What are you doing to ensure? Are you stamping anything? You're risking anybody?
Yes.
You know,
there's obviously the younger kids are obvious.
Sure.
And my brother started, because we did one practice show last year as kind of like a birthday party for my oldest. She turned 7 last year. So he started like halfway through. He was like, I'm going to start marking people who can be, you know, who can't be served. Because there were some out there that looked iffy, and sure. He went out and asked them, got the IDs, no go. So he watched them, and we didn't have any issues.
Have you considered a bracelet? A colored bracelet to put on those people who are over 21?
Yes.
Yeah, we can mark their hands.
Yeah.
But the bracelet is easier to see if you're just looking.
Right. Okay.
If a person's standing over there with a beer in their hand, you're not going to be able to see that stamp unless you go physically. You'll be able to see that bracelet if it's...
We only had
a lot of people, I would suggest a colored bracelet. Say yellow for those over 21 and red for those minor, underage, and might save a lot because you're going to be looking and looking and looking and...
Yeah. Hey. Well, it was supposed to be like a birthday party, and then it kind of like, the ring set up so you can definitely see it when you drive by. So it got, peak curiosity when people drive by. So a couple showed up here, a couple showed up there. So, we ended up with like 20, I think it was maybe 30 outside people who weren't, invited.
Well, you're going to hold these events. Are you going to stop people from walking outside onto the extended grounds that you're requesting with alcohol, or are you going to allow them to walk out there? That's the...
Yeah, we wanted them to be able to drink outside.
Right. That's what the purpose of your request is.
Yes.
So how are you ensuring you're only serving inside?
Yeah.
So one person walks up and gets one drink.
Nothing outside.
One person walks up and gets one drink. They don't get two drinks. They don't get three drinks so that they can walk out and hand them off.
There's enough of us around that I think we can take care of that.
Yeah.
I have a question on the wrestling. Mm-hmm. This sounds like a lot of fun, but the wrestling is over here on the left side near the road. Are there going to be a lot of people mingling around there that could,
go
into the road here? Or?
Yeah, that's a big tree line.
Yeah, there's a tree line there.
It's a tree line.
We're 15... I would say 15 or 20 feet actually from the road.
Oh, okay. I just saw that. I just saw a lot of people are milling around and walking all over and
no, I try roads. I try to prevent people from walking into the front yard just so I don't get a bunch of trash and stuff, obviously, in my front yard or have anything against my house personally.
Well, I know I can say that security is expensive, but on something like this, I'd have hired some security for outside just to protect you guys too if that one person went inside and took drink outside for somebody else. I mean, you never know.
We have trainees because there's a wrestling school down in Ridge.
Well, you mentioned your brother. That's only two people, your brother and you.
We have my brother, and then I have 3 to 5 trainees who will line up along those to protect us and them.
Make sure people aren't walking in the road and all that good stuff.
There is no physical barrier between extended around the horseshoe area then?
No.
It's just wide open, correct? Okay. Also, for the car show event on the side, I'm assuming you can come into the store, buy a 10-ounce Budweiser, and then walk out to look at the cars? Is that what... Now that'll work?
That's what we were hoping would work.
And then we wanted to keep them close enough to the store to where we could manage.
But what will prevent someone from taking a look at the cars and then walking over to the parking area?
Me and my brother were going to be security that day for that purpose.
For that purpose, so.
Yes.
Tammy advised to put a string up, a caution string, to keep it kind of confined.
Well, I was certainly thinking there's other ways to do that too. There's the bright orange mesh, fencing that's relatively inexpensive that you could mesh off, this is where you're allowed to drink. You cannot go in the parking lot. You might want to consider something like that. As a barrier also around the horseshoe area. That fencing is relatively inexpensive and is a highly visible and a physical deterrent for anyone walking or leaving the store or the event and going, say, well, I'm ready to go home and I haven't finished my 10-ounce Budweiser, I'm going to take it with me, you see.
Okay.
Understanding this is your first year, it looks like it's going to be interesting. What are you expecting for attendance?
For the car show or the wrestling show?
Whatever you're going to, you're looking at different dates, different events, what are you?
The wrestling show, we're not advertising, I mean, we're not like advertising as like the MCW does with the Hollywood shows and when they do it at the firehouse. We were just going to, it's pretty much going to be a community thing.
Mm-hmm.
And with friends and family. And it's mainly for the training school in Ridge for the new kids to get practice in front of a live audience. So the I would just maybe 60 people at the max. But I mean, that's at the complete max. And that's if everybody, you know, brings their, has their mother, brothers and sisters.
And sure.
And that kind of stuff show up.
I don't know, it sounds like fun. I think you better account for about 150 people.
Word gets out, social media.
That's not going to happen.
No, we don't
have the area for that.
Yeah,
and you're going to have to limit it due to your Lugum permit too, right?
Okay.
What's the limit on that?
I think the first, and I'm trying to look for it here, but you guys had wrote for your wrestling 30 to 40 attendees. And the car show, we're just 10 cars for public viewing, correct? So that's people just coming and going.
So it is conditional on the Lugum permit?
Yes. You'll be getting, are they going to, though, when you, she did her permit application, but they're going to be handing you something each time for each event,
right.
So you'll have to be
mm-hmm.
checking with them, so yes. And then you'll have to give us a copy. So yes, it will be conditional on that. Health department, not applicable.
Fire marshal?
Not applicable.
Sure.
I actually come through last year, or the last, when you had it last, and I was finishing up firearms training from Harry Lundberg, and so I figured I'd go down Blake Creek and then Natalie's Neck. And I didn't know what was going on, and then when I saw the wrestling, I thought that was the coolest thing, but at no time was there any safety matters, you know, because I was in my cruiser.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. They were a distance away from Route 244 and Blake Creek. They had the controlled atmosphere to the left rear of where the ring was. And, you know, I just thought it was an added feature that was pretty positive for that area.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I stayed and watched it a little bit to see what was going on.
Flashbacks from your wrestling days, huh?
Yeah, somewhat. So
you're going to catch up with this young man?
It caught my interest.
Becoming a...
Yeah, yeah, well, I'm too old now.
So
we
can
throw you
for,
in somehow.
Oh, yeah.
It's just for anybody who wants to wrestle?
No, they're all trained.
Oh, they're trained. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Excellent. All right. Any other questions? Do we have a motion? Conditional motion, right?
Mm-hmm. On Lugum permits.
I make the motion to approve the Russell store, the premise changes for Russell store. Janet Draper requesting temporary extension of premise for 4 outdoor wrestling events and 1 car show from May 2017 through September 2017, conditional on Lugum approval.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. Second?
I'll second that.
Very good. Any further discussion? We're carrying this like Quade store. They'll be in touch with you
mm-hmm.
as each event
yes.
comes in and so forth.
Prior to
okay.
each event, you got to bring me that permit. Okay?
Okay. All right.
Good luck.
Is that it?
You need a vote, folks?
No. I'm a little brain lock here.
All in favor?
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? No. Congratulations. Good luck
good
to
luck.
You.
Good luck.
Thank
hope
you.
It turns out and you enjoy.
The first one's May 6th. You guys can check it out.
I'll bring Bam Bam with me.
As well.
Thank you, Mr. Cole. Yeah, it was a lock. I'll tell you.
This is how you get through it quick.
It's one of those pollen days. There's pollen everywhere.
Chair. Oh, boy.
Signature.
Are there other business? Board Administrator Tammy Hildebrand?
The Chair had asked me to, in regards to our FY18 revenue legislation planning phase, we had discussed phase one being possibly adding application fees for new transfers, applications, renewal applications, any kind of license changes. I had at that time given you information in regards to the other counties in the state and what they charge, and then the chairman had asked what their staffing was like. So I don't know if anybody needs a copy of that. I have hard copies if you need it. So the staffing is the pale pink. I did go to the budget hearing for our budget, which, as I told you, it's been approved. So come July 1, Susie will be a 30-hour-a-week employee. Thank you. And at that time, did mention to the county commissioners in regards that we did have a revenue increase plan that we were working on, and got into it a little bit, what the ideas were that we would be possibly presenting to them as they became more secure. So we're still at phase one, and I'll just, if you guys got questions, if you want to, I haven't gotten a green sheet out to the county commissioners. I know you want to speak to the county commissioners in regards to this.
Absolutely. Yeah, we need their feedback.
But I'm assuming once you kind of decide what you want to do at this phase, mm-hmm. or if you want to get all phases spoken about, to me it's like a little bit at a time is better than, you know, dumping a whole bunch of stuff on people
sure.
at one time.
And it's just a suggestion, but we need their feedback. Mm-hmm. We need to know what the commissioners are thinking.
I got a little bit of feedback, but it wasn't in regards to our fees. It was in regards to
do we need to make a formal presentation to the commissioners?
Anytime you go before the commissioners, there's some formality.
Sure.
But, I mean, we need to go ahead and put that in place in order to get feedback from the commissioners, correct?
Correct.
Charles County has no other admin fee, correct? Calvert's got 250 for changes.
Charles, a lot of these folks, what I asked them was admin fees for new apps and transfers. When I got more information than what I requested, they gave it and I put it on there. So I didn't go beyond admin fees for transfers and new apps.
But Charles has got none, right?
That I don't know for sure. Sorry. Okay, you know, beyond transfers and apps, they do have a transfer and an application fee, yes. But in regards for like officer changes, renewals, I didn't ask that. So.
Okay, but because Calvert has got 250, so if you make mm-hmm. an officer change, in
anytime
Calvert,
you come before the board, it's a charge.
It's 250.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if you noticed when your applications were being approved tonight. Normally, these are people that are ready to pick up a license. Normally, I hand them a legal notice. They walk over to the treasurer's office. They pick up their license. This has changed this year in the effect that we are printing the licenses via a PDF now in our office. So now we have to create the license in our office, and then we email the PDF over to the treasurer, where the licensee will pick it up and pay for it. This adds a little time. It's not instant gratification here. So people aren't going to be able to walk out of here, walk across the street, and pick up a license anymore. And now we are printing mm-hmm. licenses for everybody. We printed all the renewals. We're doing the retail, the one-day licenses, the tasting licenses, anything that has to be printed. The only thing is we don't physically give it to them because they do have to pay, and they don't trust me with money. I'm kidding. That's not true. Okay, I'm kidding.
Just getting ready to say.
It's on tape.
Vegas. No.
Tammy, Mr. Thompson's part-time, correct? How many hours a week?
20 a week.
20 a week.
Mm-hmm. Average.
And we have 165 licenses.
Right now?
Right now.
Mm-hmm. Well, we just approved.
So with the new change coming.
Oh, yeah, the approval for.
With the approval of salons and salons. How in the world is one person part-time going to handle all that?
And one of the commissioners asked about if our increase in our budget included.
Projecting out, I'm
correct.
Sure.
For, yeah. And I explained to him that that didn't actually, with Susie's hours, what it came into initially was I gave you two choices, that the board discussed two choices, that the additional 100 hours that we needed for right now, currently what it was.
Current workload.
But then looking at the future, that the board decided let's go with the future with Susie, but no, it did not include increased hours for the inspector, it did not, or an additional inspector, and it didn't include increased hours or an additional alcohol enforcement coordinator. Because yes, there's
I guess
a few more to look at.
Yeah.
I guess my question to Mr. Thompson is your workload for the 20 hours, are you pretty well maxed out at on that workload, or?
Yes, I'm keeping up with all that we're doing here with the establishments that I inspected for the year. Right now, I'm caught up with everything. We're looking at the months ahead. I don't know what involves with the beauty salons and everything, and we just got a new licensee here I go inspect. But I'm averaging anywhere from 12 to 16 per month that I do. And I don't know how many more we get if it's just a handful of ones. Certainly I'll be able to take care of it probably, but you know, a lot more, maybe there will be more pressure.
I just think this needs to be presented carefully in the newspaper of some sort, because I've been in four places now where I've been offered wine.
There is,
and I just look and I said, you can't do it. And they said, yes, we can. So, you know, I don't argue with anybody, but I'm just saying, I don't think a lot of businesses here are aware of that they have to go apply for a license. They're not aware of a lot of things. And I mean, this is coming from a lot of people.
There's been a lot of miseducation in the county in regards to this for years now.
So I think maybe if we just put one nice letter out and say, look, this is what has to be done. And before the sheriff gets involved and before the comptroller gets involved, this is it. And one of the people I talked to, their daughters went in there for pedicures, and they checked no licenses. So
I get a call.
We have a problem
every couple
here
of
that
months,
we need to tie up right now.
I know.
And let people understand. Once they understand our process, then it's fine. But they have to know what to go. They have to have that license to give out that.
Well, you run into a lot of this is the way we've been doing it all these years.
Yeah.
And it takes a. Sometimes you can get through that mindset very easily, and sometimes it takes a little harder action.
And a lot of these people are new to the county, so the comment that I've heard is we can do it in Montgomery County. But this is not Montgomery County.
Yeah.
This is St. Mary's County, and we got to stick to
every
to
county's
what we
different.
Know and the rules. But I think once we let all, when the new, since it's coming about, the new law, this is the procedure, and this is what you have to do. And, you know, there will be questions, I'm sure, you can't charge for it, but you charge in a way, like if I'm getting my hair done.
They can charge for it.
Yeah.
They can absolutely charge for it, and they have to charge for it by law.
And the way they'll charge in a beauty salon, is if I pay $100 to get my hair done, then 6% is Maryland sales tax, and alcohol is what,
8? 9%.
They're going to have to be able to
split that out of the.
Yeah, to work it out of their.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But anyway, so I just think maybe once they're all aware what's really involved in all this.
I can talk to the PIO office and see if we can put a public announcement out for the establishments out there. Like I said, we've used this forum for years, even when Pat Inslee was the administrator. We've used this forum to try and get out to the salons that they were breaking the law.
Right. Now we can work with them, but maybe it's just got to be, hey, in print, this is what you have to do. And let them
and
follow.
I agree wholeheartedly with you. So the question is, do we need an AEC that's going to go to each beauty salon to say,
If you're doing this, you're in violation.
Yeah, and I'd like to see the law enforcer be able to go through all these places.
Well, because unless they're licensed, they don't fall under your jurisdiction. They fall under the jurisdiction of the sheriff for circumventing alcohol law and the comptroller. Those are the two.
So they're not like, but that's what I'm saying.
If
so that's
they're
why
not
we
licensed,
need
they're
that
not armed.
Entity
yes.
to walk into, I guess, the list of establishments that we're going to have to say, understand what the rules are. It was approved. It's not something that we supported,
well,
but it was approved. And it's something we have to deal with and address. That's a workload that we need to get accomplished.
I mean, there's going to be a lot of people who are not going to do this, a lot of businesses, when they figure out how they have to do the taxes. And you have to buy from a legalized distributor. Mm-hmm. You can't. Mm-hmm. This one lady mm-hmm. said that they go to the liquor store across the street in California and they buy their wine. Mm-hmm. You can't do that.
I know.
So I think once we put it out, this is what has to be followed. I think people might get a clearer understanding of what's going to be involved in
yeah.
something like this.
The other thing too is that the buying from a wholesaler, you know, there's a half a dozen of those up in Baltimore, and they're not interested in selling you three or four bottles
yeah.
of wine, you know.
I think many of them, if they want to do this, will
yeah.
actually have to go to the.
But we got to make
right.
people aware of what they're going to be, what's once we put it out, this is what's going to happen. Then they have to follow that. This is the procedure. Nobody will get in trouble. Nobody's looking. I just say
yeah.
news.
But I think the chairman's question is, whose job is it to do that?
Well, who's responsible for setting the rules as to storage of the?
Well, that's in your.
That's us when they apply, that's us for us when they apply yeah. for their license.
Yeah, and that's in the article.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to be responsible for how it is stored.
They will have to go by this, and they're also going to have to send all their employees to RASP.
Right.
And they have to be aware of that.
Well, the licensees would go.
Or the licensee, right.
The difference, Mr. Cole, is they don't fall under us right now. There's nothing that we can do. We're not walking up and we're not approaching
them. We can't go into an unlicensed
business. It's going to have to be law enforcement.
Yeah.
Because they're not applicants.
Until they make that application.
Once they have a license in hand, that's a whole nother.
Have we, I guess, looking at getting ahead of the game, are we, or should we, as a board, be developing procedures as far as storage?
No, that's already done.
That's already done? Is it in some kind of form that we can just hand to the applicant?
It's in your book. It's right here.
It's in their article. It's in the article 2B, and it's in.
Just tells them everything they have to do. That's
they,
all.
They storage. On the when you say storage, you mean where they're going to store it, how they're going to store it. That's going to fall between health and us and the article. When Garland goes in to do his inspections, he checks where they're storing their alcohol. Health department also when they go in, because when they apply for a license, the health department's going to be called and they have to go out and inspect. And they're going to tell them, no, you can't store that on the floor of your flooding basement. Mm-hmm. You know, you just can't do that. So there are rules and regs that they follow across a few agencies. I think the big concern right now is how many people who are serving alcohol at their salon or gallery are doing so illegally and are going to right themselves by getting this license. And, you know, again, once they get a license, they're under our jurisdiction and we'll watch them. Now, I have some questions on how well we can enforce this two-drink max. It's going to be difficult.
Good luck.
It's going to be difficult.
I think the only thing that upsets me, I like change. I'm for it. But you go into Walmart, you have a hair place here, and you got a nail salon, all independently owned.
Well, that's going to be, I think, a question for the attorney in regards to that. I don't know if this will also fall into that in conjunction with a grocery store,
okay,
kind of law.
I mean,
we'll
Walmart,
have to
Walmart
look.
Would love to have a liquor license. They run every business here out of business.
And this was one of those where we've been warned, where you're, and I'm sure Dave will elaborate, where the they've been warned that, you know, these big chains that want alcohol will find a way to backdoor it in.
Well, the McKay's has, when they were on Great Mills Road,
had a separate area.
With a separate retail.
With a separate
business.
With a separate register and everything else. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't as if it was walled off as a separate.
Correct. And those were
area,
those,
you know?
And those
now,
were done prior to that.
Yeah, his license was, he was grandfathered in. He was in the park since the 60s, 50s. He was grandfathered in. He took that license and.
Well, he wrote the regulations.
Right. So. All right.
All right. So.
Well,
I guess
we have a lot of work here to do. You know,
I think,
about this.
I think your concern is excellently stated. Okay. My other concern with this is when we started talking about budget and going out 3 to 5 years, trying to forecast a little bit. That started when, Tammy? January?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And we are facing an issue where now we don't know how many licensees are going to come forward.
And
the budget that we started talking about and we're trying to take baby steps into to talk and discuss with the commissioners over the next 3 to 5 years or develop, we were very fortunate to get the budget we asked for to include Susie. But
yes,
that was at the current work level,
mm-hmm.
correct?
Yes.
With a projection of quite possibly 5 or 10 licenses over the next year, and then we would come and we would work on approaching the commissioners with, this is where we think we're going to be in 3 to 5 years. Now with the passage of these bills,
you have some potential there to grow.
How many
grow faster than we've planned for already? Mm-hmm.
What's the count on beauty salons and
I think we've talked about that.
Nail
there,
salons.
There are some numbers
a,
that are already out there.
What's the number?
Well, as far as what's out there that's licensed,
right,
is about 80.
About 80
salons.
80 salons
that fall under that beauty salon licensing that is allowed in this. You have to have this particular license in order to get.
That's just beauty and salons. We've also been approved for knitting stores and
art establishments.
Art establishments. So, Hobby Lobby that's just coming in, they're going to be teaching crocheting on Thursday night, so they're going to get wine to go in there.
Well, we talked about if the passage of this bill moved, and now it has.
It has.
What other doors is that going to open? So this, we really have a lot of thinking and a lot of planning over the next few years.
Yeah.
You may not be part-time.
I'm hoping most of these places will do their homework first, you know, and see what a, it's not, I mean, it, well, you can ask Dave when he comes up to speak for the retailers. It's not an easy job, alcohol, you know, and I'm hoping that they will be dissuaded, but in talking to Montgomery County field enforcement on how do we enforce this, because Montgomery County does it.
Yeah, they've got 6 full-time
yeah, that make admin that make 80K.
And 5 okay, inspectors.
That make 80K.
You know, yeah.
But anyways, their thing was, it was hot and heavy initially. However, the demand slowed down, but the people who got them kept them. And the reason they kept them was just for, like, meaning in the big salons, not nail salons, but like the beauty salons. They kept them for when they were having bridal parties mm-hmm. or events, then they would have that. They don't use it every day.
Okay.
But your nail salons are a whole other avenue. I don't know.
How many art establishments? Do we have an idea on how many
that
art establishments? No, we don't know that. Huh?
That's definition's
that we don't know what's going to fall under.
Yeah.
What falls
subjective.
Under that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, you know.
I mean, there's hidden ones, too.
Is
like,
dance art?
Like at next to St. Joseph's, you know, keeping it local, they have one upstairs.
Right.
You know, it's just little mom and pop kind of things.
And I'm assuming that the art establishments will want to do them as premieres, you know.
Well, you're thinking art gallery. If you read the bill, it's not galleries for showing. It's also, realize this bill, when it first came out, was tailored to wine and design model, which
correct.
Is not an art gallery. It is an art teaching school.
Mm-hmm.
So if it can be considered art and you're giving lessons, kind of opens that up to a lot of different things.
Yeah.
Will that include the
Harley Davidson office?
Theater. Middle East Theater. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I do. And I don't know. I'll have to look at it. I'll have to look at it.
Yeah.
In my mind, I think I've looked at it and thought, no, there was something.
I keep thinking it's Colonial Players, but that's.
Right. Newtown Players. I don't know. It would be nice for them, but I don't know.
Because they have to apply each time.
Every time.
Every time they have a show.
They do a per diem license, correct.
Suffice to say, we're in for some work.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Anything else?
Just realized that all the legislation that passes, we're going to have to, the board has to decide if you want to put guidelines in the rules and regs. and we've got to get that done, hopefully by July.
By July?
Well, I'd like to get copies, updated copies, right, to out in the July, and it doesn't take me much time to print them.
On what we have here as far as admin fees and, you know, what we're discussing here, mm-hmm, okay, what's the next step on?
The next step is, what do you guys want to do?
Okay, so that should be open for discussion today or?
Sure.
Whenever?
Sure. I mean, when you become more cemented into what your idea is, what you think you want to instill, then I can put my green sheet in to the county commissioners and get volunteers of you to come stand with me to speak to them.
Absolutely.
Uh-huh.
And then you can get some feedback from them and then come back, share it with the board, and make a final decision.
Did you want me to make a suggestion on that? I've got one right now. Should I go ahead and put it out?
Talk about it.
Okay. I think for the admin fee for transfer of St. Mary's County, after looking at what the other counties have right now, I think it would be appropriate for the admin fee for transfers to be $250, the admin fee for new applications to be $250, and other admin fees for changes to be $200 for changes.
Can you go back?
And perhaps $100 for renewals.
All right.
Hit
the first two for me again.
$250.
Mm-hmm.
$250.
Yeah, but for what? You leave the bottom.
Oh, this is $250 for admin fee for transfers.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
A $250 admin fee for new applications.
Okay.
And then other administrative fees, $400 for changes. Any change?
No, you said $200.
I said $200.
Yes.
What did I say?
You said 200. Just now you said 400.
No. I mean 200 for, right, any change, and $100
for
renewal.
Okay.
That's what I propose.
Okay. Not to dissuade any further discussion on this right now, but please take the documents provided and study them. Come up with what you believe is a fair fee, and we need to discuss.
Yeah, I'll look at this carefully.
Yes.
Yeah.
We all need to be in agreement as to what we think is a fair fee, high, low, indifferent. Let's come to a happy median and then discuss it at the next meeting during Tammy's.
And the next meeting, we don't have any applications, so deadline's coming on.
It's going to take discussion.
Absolutely.
And we all need to be on board. Absolutely. We all have to have the same message before we approach.
And I just put those out as.
Absolutely.
As. You know,
thank you very much.
And although I did, I do put this, I do title this as FY18 legislation. These type of fees do not have to go into Article 2B, so you don't have to make a bill. You can just do it on a fee schedule in your rules and regs.
Okay, that's cool.
Oh.
Now, if you want it legislatively, that's up to you, but then you got to realize anytime you need to adjust it, you got to do legislation.
Yeah. Maybe that's some education we can get from the commissioners as to what they want us to do.
Well, the other thing, too, would this then apply to all the licensees as they are in the county today?
Well, every licensee has to renew their license every year.
Right.
Any licensee who does an officer change or a member change or a licensee
this
change.
This would all apply.
Sure.
Okay.
And just the happy little rainbow copy I gave you, the ones in green are the only ones that have it in Article 2B, just FYI.
Okay.
Now, based on, we're having an open discussion here, I'm sure that you have some comment, correct? You want to do that during your time? Come on up.
Do his time now.
That's right.
Yeah, I'm done, unless you've got questions.
Nope.
Come on up, Dave.
Take them out of sequence and...
Yep.
Mr. Chairman.
Dave's being patient.
It's all right, if I'm excused, I have another meeting.
Okay, give me one second.
Yes, sir.
Okay? We'll move on to you real quickly, and we'll come back to Ms. Hildebrand's timeframe. You were next on the list, Sheriff's Liaison Sergeant Steve Myers. What do you have for us?
Basically, everything is going well. I have my guys periodically checking locations that she has advised us of. No complaints, especially if they're not directly to you, and then you usually, we have good communication through email. So if anything does come about, you need anything, of course, the guys that work for me, they have different primary duties and responsibilities, but I can assure that certain things could be done to perhaps in an overtime status to assist with inspections if need be, but that would still have to be kind of worked out. Is it going to be alcohol enforcement funds or a sheriff's office fund?
Well, along those lines, based on today's discovery, today's discussion, we really need to be moving forward before the bills come into place. But I think it's going to be, obviously talk to Sheriff Cameron, see what he says, but I think that's not going to be an alcohol beverage issue, reaching out to the establishments who are, in fact, violating the law at this mm-hmm. stage. They're not violating our rules
right.
because they're not encompassed by us.
Right.
But because the bills are, when's the?
July 1, I think, was the effective date.
Wow.
Right. July
1. I'm used to law enforcement, October 1.
Some of them go.
I was thinking
one,
we had 5 or 6
July
months.
1.
Yeah, it's July 1st.
That we could do this. If it's July 1, that is a very rapidly approaching date. But that's a workload for you guys, and I understand.
And July 1st will be the first day that they can apply for these new licenses. Okay.
And I agree with you in reference to a public announcement.
Yeah. We'll be doing that.
Making the public aware of the new bill. Mm-hmm. And specifically telling the public in these type establishments, mm-hmm. if you think that you want to serve alcohol, they have to first contact you.
There's a process, absolutely.
Yeah, I think that's neat.
At least you're putting it out there,
yeah.
Making it aware, because anything I do with like levying property, I have to put it in the paper, mm-hmm. so mm-hmm. making people aware. So at least they'll have knowledge of it. And if they violate it at that time, then there's no excuse.
I think we need to make the public aware.
Absolutely.
I think it'd be great if we did that and mm-hmm. provided for them the steps and that, so not everybody's confused. And
mm-hmm. now who's going to put that together?
Tammy's going to take care
of it. I'll put something out to the PIO.
Okay.
Ted
well,
put it together.
And get yeah, their, I was going to say,
and get their
it'll come, Tammy. We'll all... I'd like to see it authored, whatever needs to be
absolutely.
Done, but before
yeah.
it goes to the PIO,
sure.
ensure that we're covering
all the bases.
Yeah,
yeah.
I'd like
done.
To talk
okay.
to a few people.
No problem.
And that's basically all I have.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Take care of yourself.
Yeah, enjoy.
Thank you.
Okay, right back thank to Ms. Hildebrand's time frame. Mr. Dent, step right up, sir.
Happy Easter.
Yes.
Good afternoon, everybody. David Dent on behalf of the St. Bruce County Licensed Beverage Association.
So you've heard some of the discussion here.
Yes, sir.
Obviously, I know you have some input. I'm sure that the all the retailers will have some input, so hit us.
Yes, sir. We have discussed the proposal. We obviously, if the liquor board needs funds, you know, we're supportive of that. We'd like to be involved with the discussion about what services are a fee is required for what services and what that fee would be. But we don't oppose the concept of having fees.
Well, and I think somebody said it here earlier, I can't remember who, it might have been Ms. Hildebrand. Clearly, there's a process we'll go through, and we'll make it as fair as possible to everyone involved.
Yes, sir.
That's our number one goal, but we realize that we have a deficit and we need to address it. Hitting everybody right off the bat with a few hundred dollars may not be the answer, because everybody's right. been in business for years, and I think you had said it makes more sense to me. We might want to move into this a little slower. Luckily, Mr. Cole's given us some numbers that we can address, but I just don't want to come out of it. I don't think any of us want to come out of the gate
yeah.
and hit you with, this is what we're going to do.
Exactly.
Okay, there's going to clearly be some back and forth.
So. Maybe even a phase-in period
yes.
or something.
Yes. Exactly what I was thinking.
Yes.
Ramp it up, you know.
Yep. Mr. Dent, can we get something from your association then as to a range, say, of what you all think is equitable?
Because you talk about different licenses and what they should be, and it would be interesting right. to see what your input would be towards that before we go.
I mean, even the privileges of one license versus another, you know, I don't want to make it very super complicated,
sure.
but someone that only has like a beer license, there's I believe a few licensees that only sell beer,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
perhaps their fee shouldn't be as much as someone that is a beer, wine, and liquor
Excellent
license.
Point. Mm-hmm. Yep.
You know, just because from the revenue side, how much revenue they're making.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So, you know, I think it needs study, and I think, you know, if we can figure out a fair way to apply it to everybody in a phase-in period, so, it, you know, we have an opportunity to build it into our budgets. As responsible retailers, you know, we want to make sure that this board is viable and able to do its job as well, so.
Mm-hmm. Can you have something for us, say, at the next meeting? Or the meeting after June, in June, because we're going into these new licenses come July 1.
Yes, sir.
You know, something say by June, that gives you two meetings?
Yes, sir. I'll do my very best. I can't absolutely say 100% that I can have that for you, but we'll try to hit that deadline. Yes, sir.
So when you say graduated fees or you're talking like maybe based on what they pay for the license, a possible percentage
or maybe even just you know, not bringing like the renewal fee on immediately, you know, maybe
right.
scaling
right.
in a couple of the fees,
plan it out over the years
and mm-hmm. right, you know, maybe yeah. after year two or year three yeah. we could add
right,
the renewal
right.
fee, for example.
Well, then we're looking at like a 5-year plan, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So let's see, if we're within that context of a 5-year plan.
No, it's something that we'll kick around. I understand
yeah,
exactly
yeah.
what you're saying, and at no point will you not be involved, and will the retailers not be involved in
right.
this discussion, okay? But I want to see everything. I want to say, okay, are we going to put this in and we're going to graduate it over 3 years, over 5 years, or we're going to, I really like your suggestion of someone who is selling one item only, beer only, should not, I don't think at this stage, be required to pay the same fee that someone who's selling beer, wine, and liquor.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Okay, just because of the margins and so forth. When we have a plan of action and we've discussed it with you, I would hope that you would be standing with us in support when we go to talk to the commissioners to get their feedback to see where we need to be and what we think is fair.
As long as we're in agreement, yes, sir.
I took that as a threat. No.
We haven't come to agreement with him yet.
I'm with you. I'm with you. But
I think that's possible,
sure.
Yes, sir.
Sure. Excellent. All right. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Anything else? Tammy, any questions of Mr. Dent?
No.
As always, he is a wealth of knowledge.
I'm sure he's got some more to tell us about the legislation.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anything you've got to say? Anything you'd like to say? This is your time.
Sure, if we're moving on to the
yep.
Retail Association.
Yep.
Huh?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Well, as you know, the General Assembly is over. They ended this week in our Ostrom. Some things that did pass, some things that didn't pass that I'd like to pass along with you. Obviously, the local St. Mary's County bills were passed, the Beauty Salon Bill and the Arts Establishment License Bill, they were both passed. And I think going forward, perhaps, as a suggestion, the board might want to just put some rules and regulations in place in the local rule book just to facilitate and make sure everybody, like you were, the discussion you were having earlier, make sure everybody understands what they do mean and what they don't mean.
Mm-hmm.
And would be certainly be happy to work with you on that if you'd like us to. One of the most important bills, I believe, that passed this year was some compromise legislation about breweries. I'm not sure if you're all familiar with the brewery bill.
Mm-hmm.
Diageo was bringing in a Guinness plant in Relay, Maryland, and there were some discussions on how, you know, we could accommodate that.
Mm-hmm.
A compromise bill was reached with the Brewers Association of Maryland, the Beer Wholesalers, and our state Retail Licensed Beverage Association. And the compromise that was reached was to raise, and this is for production breweries, not microbreweries. This is the larger breweries. So the production breweries had the cap from 500 barrels of beer that they could sell on site, from 500 to 2,000, with the possibility of getting another 1,000. So actually a 3,000 barrel limit of mm-hmm. amount of beer that they can sell on site.
Per year?
Per year, yes, sir.
Per year.
Another compromise that was made is there's something called contract brewing, which is before this bill is enacted, it's actually not legal to do this, where one brewery can produce beer for a second brewery, and then you can bring it back to your brewery and sell it. During the course of the bill being discussed, it was found out that was actually occurring. So part of the compromise was to put in this
hence
bill.
Hence the reason for the bill.
Exactly.
Right.
Was to we compromised to allow that to be able to occur legally. And part of what that does is for the brewery, the Guinness Brewery in Relay, Maryland, for example, they're going to produce a Guinness Blonde and some other beers that it's only going to be brewed exclusively at that plant. But they wanted the opportunity to bring over Guinness Stout and also have that available for sale in their tap room. And this compromise allows them to bring a small percentage, make have a small percentage of their sales to bring in things that they still have to be brewed by the same company, by the same brewery, but they can be brewed at another location and brought in. It's a small percentage.
Where's the stout brewed? In
Ireland.
In Ireland, and then they bring it in. Where's the Guinness Brewery at in Maryland?
It's in Relay, Maryland.
What is it?
Relay, Maryland.
Relay?
Yes, sir.
And where's that?
It's in Baltimore.
In Baltimore.
Near Baltimore. Baltimore County. Yes, sir. There were originally three or a few bills. One was just for the Guinness plan, a Baltimore County bill, and then there was another put in by the Brewers Association, and then there was actually a bill put in by our association. One of the other factors is also the amount of hours that they can operate. Currently, the hours that the tap rooms can operate at the breweries were the hours that were given to them by their local liquor boards. In order to sell, to have a tap room and sell their own product at the brewery, they have to get a Class D license in order to do that. So they have their production brewery license, and then if they have a tap room where they sell their product on site, they have to get a Class D license. And so with part of the new law going forward, we grandfathered mm-hmm. in everybody that was existing to let them keep their existing hours, but any new breweries are going to have a 10 p.m. limit is what they can sell. The part of the problem with this bill, it kind of attacks the three-tier system. The breweries now are the manufacturer, they distribute to themselves, and then they also retail. So that was part of our issue with it. But, you know, we found that, you know, the compromise was best. I mean, you know, we wanted Guinness and Diageo to have a plant here that's very good for Maryland. And, you know, this is how we figured we could bring it into our state and support our brewers in our state as well.
Now, this is only for brewery, not winery, correct?
This legislation was for, yes, just breweries.
Just brewery.
Yeah.
Okay. Is there anything on the horizon as far as winery goes?
There's always new legislation with wineries, so I wouldn't, you know, I don't know if there's anything in the, you know, coming down along the same lines as this, but there was some legislation in to allow wineries. They can do similar things as the breweries like this, and actually they had the privilege first. But there's some legislation that they want to be able to bring in not only their wine that they sell when they do like a wedding reception or something, but also to bring in beer and spirits as well. So, you know, it seems to be the trend. So that was one of the important bills that passed. A bill that didn't pass, luckily, there was another warehouse shopping club bill from Montgomery County that was put in by someone in Montgomery County. Unfortunately, that bill didn't come out of committee, it died in committee, was voted against. So, you know, we're okay with that. Montgomery County also, they put in another bill for Class A package store licenses to allow a store in Montgomery County to have a second Class A license. That bill also didn't come out of committee. So we think that was a victory. There was, speaking of the wineries, and there was a bill put in to allow wineries to have an auxiliary location, meaning that...
Storage?
No, a retail front.
Okay.
And although that was passed out of the House, neither the House or the Senate bill was taken up by the Senate committee, so that bill failed. The direct wine shippers permit, that passed a few years ago where if wine wasn't available in the state of Maryland, a winery that produced the wine could ship it into a customer directly. For example, if you went out to California and you found this really good wine that you liked and it wasn't available for sale in Maryland, you could contact that winery and they could get a license through the comptroller in order to directly ship wine into you. You know, as long as they got the permit through the comptroller and, you know, paid all the taxes, they could ship it from the winery to you personally at your house. That bill passed a few years ago, but what we found out was what was occurring was there were marketing companies that were able to secure a winery license in another state without actually producing wine. And they were becoming a marketing company shipping wine into Maryland. So, you know, we talked with the comptroller about this and they suggested that we put a bill in to fix that, where the language now says you have to have a winery license and you actually have to make wine.
Is that Drizzly? Is that one of the ones?
No, Drizzly is the delivery service. Is more like First Leaf. And some other marketing companies, okay. Like one of the month clubs.
Every time you turn around, there's something else. Yes.
The hidden consequences of legislation, that's all.
So I think we were able to do that where, you know, you have to actually be a wine producer as well as have a winery license in order to ship. Common sense stuff, but...
Somebody's got an angle.
It's not in writing.
Exactly. And then another bill that passed through was the Crowler bill. I think I mentioned that to you guys, not the Growler bill, but the Crowler bill. The Crowler is not refillable containers, but a sealed one-time can container. So the legislation that passed said if you had a Growler permit, you could also do Crowlers.
Got to add that into the reg.
Yep.
And there's some other bills, but that's basically it. Unless anybody has any questions about any of those or any of the other ones, I'll be happy to try to answer them for you to the best of my ability.
You wrote that down, right?
Yeah.
Add that to the regs. More work.
Mm-hmm.
Joy.
Mm-hmm.
Any questions? Thank you very much, Mr. Dent.
Yeah, certainly. Thank you guys for your time. Appreciate it. Mm-hmm.
Mr. Thompson, Board Inspector Garland Thompson, you're up.
Yes, sir. Okay, for beside all the calls and emails and checkouts with noncompliance and so forth reports, and I had a few repairs to the vehicle. You've got a new battery for our ABB vehicle. I even did one posting for the month, but for the month of March, I inspected 14 establishments and also had 8 follow-ups. Also helped out with the March 28th RAS class, which Administrator Mrs. Hildebrand and myself performed, and we're still doing it by ourselves.
Do we need any assistance on that front there, Tammy?
It would be nice to have, I mean, I'm chomping at the bit. It took me, what, two or three classes to finally get comfortable with the AEC portion of it, but still we do have people who ask law enforcement questions that I'm not skilled enough to, I don't have that skill set. So, I mean, we will refer them, we will get the answers if we can, but it's nice to have law enforcement there. And not to mention, they're out in the field. They're the ones that are seeing, you know, the changes and new things that they can pop into the RAS training. Because our RAS training is fluid. It's not the same every time. There's a lot of things that are standard, but, you know, we talk about right now PA licenses are hot. Next month it might be Ohio, you know, and when you have a deputy out there who's collecting this kind of information, they bring that to the table. And that way we can keep the licensees abreast of what's new out there that they got to watch out for. So
Sergeant Myers, is he just part-time? He's not
Sergeant Myers is not an alcohol enforcement coordinator.
He's just
our liaison.
Contact to the sheriff.
Why can't we get Deputy Stone back? My God, he's been with us all these years and knows everything.
I got him on patrol.
Gosh. So, never mind. We just don't have an inspector right now, so.
We're just, you know, it is what it is.
I will say you're looking very springy.
Thank you.
I'm enjoying the colorful outfit.
I'll pick up this operation.
Anything else?
Is it the?
I just want to ask Arnold, have you found that a lot of the establishments you're going to have posted their signs out in front of their building about alcohol consumption?
That's right.
No drinking outside?
I'm constantly going back. That's because you saw 8 follow-ups. I'm going back and forth reminding these people, keep your signs up. Those signs are torn down. They're getting faded. And they're keeping up much better now. It's been, for the 6 years I've been on the board, with the board here, that was one of my intentions, was to have them keep up with everything that, every regulation that's in that book. And by doing so, it keeps on their toes. It seemed like they now at more ease with me. And what the board wants, but not my laws, I tell them is what y'all have inside the book and the rules and regulations. So I'm seeing a better, positive, more attitude for all the licensees. And anyway, I still have to get on for you. And they don't seem to understand. They have their own way, but they come along. There's when we get back to the misunderstanding of things, and even the licensees that we have, they either get in a rut or something, they forget what's in that book, they haven't kept up reading with it. And so I'm always reminding them and going back with Tammy with things that I see that they're just not catching. And I encourage reading that book, using it at employee meetings, and I'm really telling that up a lot. Mm-hmm. And then remind them about our RAS class, even the licensee with the violation I had already gave them paperwork when I inspected a couple months back, and they was presented with knowledge that we have in RAS class now at the last Tuesday of every month. So I think that's very important.
I want to thank you for keeping the message consistent and professional. I know that, didn't we just get something?
Yes, we just got a letter of commendation from one of the licensees.
Thanking
Inspector
really nice.
Thompson and mm-hmm. for his work and keeping them. And I can tell you, mm-hmm. tax season's here, and I guarantee you there are a lot more happy accountants out there, you know, because we do, I mean, people are starting to realize that, you know, when he first goes in there and realize Inspector Thompson can only go out once a year per establishment. So he is we lovingly have a slide with his car and the trunk open and the camel in the car. Because he is basically our education on wheels.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But a lot of them initially are like, oh, this is so much more work. But then once they see and they implement, they realize that their life has just gotten a lot easier. So, you know, you still have a few that, you know, it is what it is, you know. But yeah, he's an asset that most licensees are really beginning to appreciate if they had it in the past.
Sure.
Mr. Thompson, you have no jurisdiction now on signage, correct? Well, I mean, you know, the sign ordinance as it is today.
Only what I have in your book that I enforce, in the reg book, that they got to have these signs up.
He's talking about liquor advertising, right?
Yeah.
Liquor advertising. No,
that's nothing bad. That's not us.
If I see one that's really locked over across the windows, I'm just making sometimes comments and saying, you know, policemen may not be able to see in here. I've done that in the past. And I had one liquor store that a distributor came by and put one of their signs across this. It's a see-through sign, but it covered up the no drinking parking lot. So I drove by and I seen that, and I had to pull over and go in, and he had to cut that away off that sign so that our sign would be shown.
Stay vigilant. You stay vigilant. I think it sums it all up in quality of character. You've done a great job. Thank you very much. Thank you. Next on the list is Community Alcohol Coalition, Ms. Lauren Abel.
Good morning.
How are you doing?
Again, not so much this month. I'm still working with the state in the initial phases of the grant. We are looking to help out with Tammy and kind of enhance the responsible member service training. Kind of look at the gaps there and see where maybe our grant funding can help make it better for our licensees. We're also exploring, obviously, these strategies were aligned when we had Officer Stone with us. We are greatly missing him because he helped us a lot too with our grant initiative. So we were looking to kind of help our retailers with the compliance check side of it, especially with underage and over service for the binge drinking portion of our grant. Kind of have to re-navigate that a little bit now that we don't have that person to go to directly for questions. So that is a little bit of a barrier for us, and we're trying to figure out how to navigate that. And then additionally, we are looking to potentially explore a social host ordinance depending on what we find. We're in the very beginning stages of that, so nothing to be alarmed at right now, but that is our intention as policy change and environmental strategies tend to show more long-standing effects than other strategies in decreasing underage and binge drinking in the community, which is our sole purpose. Other than that, that's what we're working on. Hopefully more to come once everything gets kind of rolling. Right now we're in kind of the building stages of it as we operate on a July 1 fiscal year as well. So hopefully over the summer we'll have some more for you guys. Our next meeting will be on April 25th. It's at noon over at the Outpatient Department of Health Connections. You're welcome to join if you have time. Obviously, I know you guys have other duties as assigned as well, but that's all I have for you guys unless there's any other questions.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Take care. All right, so we've kicked around this stuff. Any further discussion here, folks?
Can we table for next meeting?
What?
The amount of license fees for the town of Leonardtown that...
You mean you want to bring that into discussion?
A discussion, yeah. For our next meeting. I'm kind of interested in this because the law goes back to 1957 and we get none of these fees. That's almost $12,000 we could be using our budget.
5%.
That goes to the commissioners?
We have a commissioner. I don't know if he's just here observation or if he wants a little input.
I mean, this goes back to 1957.
It's an MOU between our commissioners and the corporate commissioners of Leonardtown.
Every fee that we collect in the town of Leonardtown goes to the town of Leonardtown, not to the board.
There's a 5% administration that we keep.
Yeah.
I would say that that be part of what the discussion is as far as the, what we're talking as far as the changes in the administrative costs,
right,
and everything else, all of that. I think if we're looking at the package, you know, I think that is certainly an element.
That'd just be interesting just to figure, I mean, that's been long ago, just to get us up to date as to why we're doing this. That's all.
Not sure that written MOU is probably archived somewhere, but I mean.
Well, everything can be updated and brought up to date, so.
I think that's probably, if there was something you want to change, you definitely have to have some conversation between the corporate town and your county commissioners.
And your county commissioners.
Because that would be a legislative change,
right,
which you would need support for, yes.
Okay, that's all I have.
I really have no comment.
You got the ball.
I know, right? Thank you for bringing that up. Anything else? We good? Big Jim?
I'm good.
Okay, sir.
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn, second?
Second that.
Woohoo!
You first, second.
First, Mr. Hall. Second, Mr. Cole. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.